Thanks to all of you. It's great to see you here this morning. And I want to give particular thanks to Craig Stern, Ernie Walton, Chris Troy for your organizing of this event, and the great team of students who put this together. I am amazed every time I come to an event that happens here, what it is that our students do in putting this together and running and organizing these events. And students, I just want to tell you on behalf of our faculty how really proud we are of what you accomplish and what you do here. And so thank you for this. It's been a great morning so far as we've been talking about women's rights in the United States. And we're now going to be transitioning to talking about women's rights around the world. And particularly, how do we protect women's rights when sometimes human rights norms, and maybe even international commitments that have been signed and ratified, conflict with cultural values in certain nations? And so that'll be the focus of our panel this morning. And we've got some outstanding people to talk about these issues with you. And so as happened in the first panel, I'd like to just share with you a little bit about each of the speakers. I'll introduce all of them first, and then they'll come up one after the other. But I'm going to tell you about each of them now. First, we're very privileged to have Professor Azizah al-Hibri. She is a professor emerita at the University of Richmond Law School, having served on the faculty from 1992 until her retirement just 4 years ago. Her work has centered on developing an Islamic jurisprudence and body of Islamic law that are gender equitable and promote human rights and democratic governance. Professor al-Hibri has authored numerous book chapters, essays, and law review articles on these subjects, and her work has appeared in the highly respected Journal of Law and Religion, the Harvard International Review, and the University of Pennsylvania Journal of Constitutional Law, among other venues. In 2011, Professor al-Hibri was appointed by President Obama to serve as a commissioner on the U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom. She received the Virginia First Freedom Award from the Council for America's First Freedom in 2007, and the Dr. Betty Shabazz Recognition Award from Women in Islam in 2006, and the University of Richmond's Distinguished Educator Award in 2004. She was named a Fulbright Scholar in 2001. She is the founding editor of Hypatia, a journal of feminist philosophy, and a founder and president of the organization Karama, Muslim Women Lawyers for Human Rights. Our second speaker will be Professor Christine Venter. She's the director of the Legal Writing Program at Notre Dame Law School. She earned her BA degree from the University of Cape Town and her law degree from the University of Cape Town School of Law, where she was the editor-in-chief of the Law Review. She also holds an LLM in International Law and Human Rights, summa cum laude, from Notre Dame Law School, and a JSD also from Notre Dame. After graduation, Professor Venter worked as an associate for a South African firm specializing in civil rights litigation. After relocating to the U.S., she worked for a firm specializing in international business law and later did legal aid work in the United States. She is a member of the Legal Writing Institute, the Association of Legal Writing Directors, and is an editor of the Journal of the Legal Writing Institute. Our third speaker will be Professor Isaac Kfir. He is a visiting assistant professor of international relations and law at Syracuse University, where he currently teaches post-conflict reconstruction and the rule of law, international security, terrorism in the 21st century, EU law and policy, and humanitarian action, among other classes, all of which I would like to take. Professor Kfir is a research associate at INSCT and an assistant director of the Global Black Spots Project in the Moynihan Institute of Syracuse's Maxwell School. Between 2005 and 2009, Kfir was an assistant professor at the Interdisciplinary Center in Israel. Before working at the IDC and ICT, he served as a research fellow in international relations at the University of Buckingham. He received his PhD from the London School of Economics and International Relations, and he has a postgraduate diploma in law, the Bar Vocational Certificate from BPP Law School. He was a member of the Inner Temple in England. He's been published in numerous journals. He's currently working on two book manuscripts, Post-Conflict Reconstruction in the 21st Century, a proposal submitted to Cambridge University, and terrorism and counterterrorism, a critical approach to the way states respond to terrorist threats. And that's been submitted to Stanford University Press. And he has a manuscript under review, Democracy and Pakistan, Past, Present, and Future, with Duke University Press. And then our final speaker will be Tiffany Barrans, who most recently served as the International Legal Director at the American Center for Law and Justice, and also served as a senior litigation counsel in domestic litigation matters. As senior litigation counsel for the ACLJ, Ms. Barrans participated in several First Amendment cases at all levels in the United States federal courts. In her capacity as international legal director, Ms. Barrans assisted in cases throughout Europe, Africa, Asia, and the Middle East, and worked as a liaison between the ACLJ and its international affiliate offices. She has also represented matters of international concern before the United Nations, the European Court of Human Rights, the European Parliament, and various national parliaments around the world. We are very proud that Ms. Barrans graduated at the top of her class at this law school, where she served as the editor-in-chief of the Law Review. She received her BA from the University of Puget Sound, and before clerking, working for the ACLJ, she clerked for the Honorable William Pryor of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit. She serves as a senior research associate for the Oxford Center for Law and Public Policy, and frequently contributes to the global discussion of religious freedom through writing and public speaking. And I will just tell you on a personal note, Tiffany is one of the most capable and impressive young women who have ever come through this institution, and we are deeply proud of you, Tiffany. This is a great panel, and so would you please join me in welcoming all panelists. Dr. Al-Hibri will ask you to come and join us at first.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you so much for inviting me here. I'm so impressed by this law school already and having heard the first panel. The topic of the panel today is women's rights abroad. We've done the domestic stuff. And when we think about that, I think about all the work I've done, especially in the 90s. In those days, the State Department had a department called USIA, United States Information Agency, which is now public education. And I got invited to travel with as their guest to many of the Muslim countries to basically deliver my message about Islam as a gender equitable religion and issues of democracy, etc. I remember it was almost like a campaign. Today is Thursday, I must be in whatever. But it was very, very informative, and in fact, it continues to inform my work till this day as I write the second volume of my book. But those days followed, I must say that as a preparation for what I'm going to say next, I was part of the feminist movement in the 60s. That's when I established Hypatia. I was a philosophy professor at that time. And we were very concerned during those days about the fact that men were speaking in our own voice, that women did not have a direct voice in the discussion, in the debate, in determining issues. What happened in the 90s or in the 80s, as the feminist movement was going global, is that American women started talking on behalf of other women, and therefore the other women did not have their voice. For this reason, I decided to found Karama, because my sisters here needed to give me elbow room so that when I talk to the Muslim women, they will feel that it is one of them talking to them overseas. That was very important because you don't remember the 90s. Some of you might not have been born by then. I don't know. But there was a lot of money going overseas and a lot of NGOs that were funded by organizations here in order to advance the line at that time, including distributing contraception to peasants, you know, because they're having too many children. I remember this was happening in Egypt, for example, and one of my papers on population issues was to be used, and I had to restrict the use of that so that it doesn't get misused. So the American women and Western women in general who were going overseas to liberate the Muslim women were doing a lot of things, and the best way to describe their efforts is that they were an elephant in a crystal room, China room. And then the USIA tells me to go and lecture about Muslim women's rights, and when I do, usually I'm after them. They've already been there, and then I go after them. And usually the first day or two of my visit to any country is spent trying to assure them, I'm not CIA. I am not doing what the Western women who came before me were doing. I'm going to talk to you from within your culture and from within, most more importantly than culture, from within your religion. And I remember, and there are State Department faxes to back this up. In one lecture on democracy, there was a group in a country which was very hostile to our embassy and would not attend any of their activities. But finally, when I arrived, they invited them and they came. And at the end of the lecture, the head of the group came up to the people of the embassy and hugged them and kissed them and said, oh, I didn't know that, you know, you had such people in the United States. So we were not only helping the women abroad, we were building, you know, we were doing good faith efforts in terms of the relationship. So it is very important that when we are talking about Muslim women, that we do not otherize them. Quickly, there are over a billion Muslims, right? And let's say half of them are women. So could they all be the same? I mean, you just said in the previous panel, women are not all of the same mind. Yeah, with a half a billion or three quarters of a billion, I can assure you they're not of the same mind, and I can assure you they're not of the same culture, and therefore they have different issues. They have different problems. Unfortunately, what has happened in this country because of the war in Afghanistan and the Taliban is that that image has been generalized to all Muslim women. I'm standing before you. Do you think I look like that because I'm an American? No, I grew up looking like that. I was born in Lebanon. There are different areas in the Muslim world. There is the North Africa with an ancient history and traditions. There is the Middle East, similarly, the cradle of civilization. You have the Gulf, and then you have China, you have India, you have Pakistan. You just cannot generalize. So I would suggest that trying to deal with Muslims or Muslim women and talking to them about gender equality requires real sensitive knowledge of the audience you're addressing and what is going on. What is the dynamics of the audience? What's the culture that they are coming from? Because very often, historically, the culture has found its way into what in those countries people think is Islamic law. So they don't realize it's patriarchal culture. They think it's God's word. And you come and try to challenge that part of the law, and of course they are very upset. But if you are familiar with the jurisprudence, familiar with the religion, you can unpack this, you can disassemble it, and you can show them what is religion and what is culture, and then tell them it's their choice. Do they want to follow culture or religion? Especially when the two on human issues, human rights issues, conflict. If the culture is patriarchal and your religion is telling you not to be patriarchal, which way are you going to go? And invariably, they're going to choose religion. And I think that's the way that we need to talk to them. Let me say that we have done a lot of that at Karama, the organization referred to in the introduction. Every year, we select about 25 women, Muslim women leaders from around the world. But half of them should be American, half should be foreign, because we want them to interact with each other. And the one thing that the women first notice is that when they get into the room together, whether they're worshiping or talking, they're very different, but they're all Muslim. So yes, Islam has a variety, and you need to tolerate that variety. You don't need to say, I'm right, you're wrong. So that's one of the first lessons that they learn about Islam by simply being together. Of course, we also teach them about gender equity in Islam, et cetera, et cetera. So education has been the hallmark of our work. But, you know, why am I talking about all this? Let me just not be diplomatic with you anymore. I'm gonna be blunt, because neither you nor I have time for niceties, really. Daesh, which is the way I refer to ISIS, has spread like an octopus across the various continents. You may not know this, but men in this organization have killed and raped more Muslim women, and incidentally Muslim men as well, more of these men and women than women from or men from any other religion. Everybody has been victimized. That, of course, does not relieve the pain of the Yazidi women in Iraq, some of whom I saw on television. It broke my heart. I also saw in person other places. Their whole families were wiped out. You know, let me give you a very personal example. 7 years ago, I lost my very dear brother to an illness, protracted illness. I don't know how God helped me survive that, because I loved him so dearly. How did this woman survive the loss of all her family, parents, brothers, sisters? This is not just a number or a story or a statistic. This is a human tragedy. And she also lost her personal dignity through rape, some of them through enslavement. She was enslaved too. I saw her on Egyptian television. This is very sad and very outrageous indeed. In light of these momentous problems, I cannot engage in the luxury of talking about Muslim women's rights as I would have before Daesh. Like, do they have the right to this? Do they have the right to that? The most basic right is the right to exist and to exist with dignity, and I have to address that. It's really important to address their issue. We need to come up with the right answers if we would like peace and harmony to return to the world. And I mean the world, I don't mean just the Middle East. The root of all evil in this world is injustice. For God is just. In fact, God is justice itself. This is not retributive justice only, which seeks an eye for an eye. This biblical principle I'm referring to, which also is mentioned in the Quran, was introduced simply to designate the limits of distributive justice. Namely, you cannot take two eyes for an eye. But then our religions went on to follow a higher form of justice, that of forgiveness and compassion. The world in these crazy days seems to have forgotten about restorative justice, about forgiveness and compassion. That's the evil I'm feeling in the world. But it is important to understand that any imbalance in justice in this world affects us all sooner or later. In this case, the issue of Muslim women's rights is patently one of justice, as you all understand, and it is justice within our community, not justice across necessarily. For too long, our Muslim communities across the world have given free rein to their patriarchal cultural inclinations. In the end, these inclinations turned the Islamic system of justice upside down, literally upside down, and made the people believe that it was right side up. That did not happen suddenly. Before it was possible to exile Muslim women from the public sphere, in which they were fully active at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, feel free to ask me any questions you want later about this, something else happened within a few decades of the death of the Prophet. Now, the very system of democratic governance developed by the Prophet Muhammad in the city of state of Medina was replaced within a few decades of his death by the rule of force. In his life, people chose, people voted. Within like 40 some, several decades later, it was the use of force that imposed a ruler on the people. In other words, the Muslim community lost its democratic liberties, and that terrible event resulted in multiple catastrophes whose consequences we still suffer from till this day. Muslim women in particular suffered significant consequences. Therefore, to rectify the situation today requires a very serious and thoughtful effort to bring back the Islamic system of justice and democracy, beginning with guarantees of human rights and freedom of conscience. In the meantime, Daesh has built its own religious arsenal against this change by indoctrinating young, gullible Muslim, mostly men around the world, but some women. Daesh or its predecessors have argued early on that democracy was against Islam, and I remember lecturing extensively against that position, that education of women was prohibited in Islam, which, by the way, is totally contradictory to the teachings of the Prophet, that anyone who believes anything different from what Daesh believes, including other Muslims, not just non-Muslims, was an infidel. That's why they killed so many Muslims. And its actions, Daesh's actions, shamelessly destroyed religious freedom, which the Quran and the Prophet himself declared to be of the essence of Islamic belief. Today, Daesh's use of the early symbol of Islamic democracy, Khilafa, they call themselves Khilafa, to destroy democratic governance and reestablish a state based on the use of force, is very disconcerting, and it has spread mischief in this earth. How can we educate about women's rights without addressing this whole issue from the roots up? It's all connected. We cannot act like women are like a special interest group sitting in a world full of violence and problems and so on, but the women are, you know, guess what, we can treat you differently and we can give you all the rights denied to the rest of the society. One problem we run into, I run into, comes from here in the United States. People here also have understood Islam for centuries as it has been presented to them by either interested or uninformed sources. So when someone like me tries to argue in favor of Islamic justice and Muslim women's rights and democracy, I come under criticism from some of my audience. You're whitewashing Islam. So while we are endangering our lives to speak boldly about the roots of the problem and not offer band-aid easy solutions to it, we also have to bear the attacks from our own compatriots, American compatriots, impugning our motives and sometimes mocking our attempts. This is really a very difficult position to be in because you're getting punched from the left and the right. Nevertheless, we have no option but to forge ahead. This is why I retired from the University of Richmond in 2012. And began writing a series of books on Islam. And believe it or not, because when I write them in English, people think, oh, she's writing it for us non-Muslims. No, 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 no. I'm writing it for Muslims, and you're welcome to read it too. Because I'm trying to educate Muslims as much as anybody else, re-educate them about what Islam really is about. It's not about what Daesh says it is. I brought a recent first book to the library. So if any of you would like to read, this is very basic, just lays the foundation. And the next book is going to be about family law, and I'm in the middle of writing it. So as this book illustrates, I'm not just repeating what has been said before me. What I'm doing is taking a look which is steeped in tradition. That's the only way to prove to people, Muslims in particular, that what you're doing is honest and they should listen to it and take it seriously. So after I lay the basic foundations of the faith that every Muslim upholds, I begin unpeeling the authoritarian patriarchal onion. And I do think that patriarchy and authoritarianism come hand in hand. I remove them layer by layer to reveal the Islamic message in its earliest and yet very modern form that lies underneath all this. This is a painful process for many Muslims because many of them grew up with patriarchal beliefs that they were told were Islamic as opposed to cultural. The revelation that they are not so, but are instead rooted in culture is painful and slow for many. But if the message gets through, then the message becomes permanent and stable. That's what's so good about it. Instead of trying to whip people into a frenzy and then they go out of the lecture room and nothing is left there because they didn't really learn anything. You just moved them emotionally. We want to educate. That is what we want, a stable and permanent reaction. And that can only be accomplished by knowledgeable Muslim jurists teaching these views to the public and to our summer class I told you about. One example of this, and I'm wrapping up here, is what happened in Morocco last month. I was there. It was about the Marrakesh Declaration. I don't know if any of you heard about it, but if not, I will send you a copy of it. We all, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, Hindu, etc., met there to discuss religious freedom in Islam, and then issued a Marrakesh Declaration which emphasizes the right of the freedom of conscience in Islam. This is basic. This is non-negotiable. But this is one step. Democracy is another. Women's rights is yet another. These are all interrelated by the system of Islamic justice, and we cannot just have one of these and not the other. So the road before us is long, difficult, and dangerous. But we have to take it. We owe it to humanity. We owe it to our faith. We will not always be perfect, but we believe in hard work and the importance of our work for the whole world community, for humanity. Thank you.
Slides, which is going to make you feel like you're in class again after listening to that wonderful presentation, so I kind of apologize for that. So I just want to talk about a little bit about preserving and protecting women's rights in Africa, and I'm going to talk about it because you are all lawyers or soon to be lawyers from a legal perspective, and that doesn't mean that I only believe in what I'm going to call top-down enforcement of women's rights, so enforcements in constitutions and by courts and by legislatures. But I know Tiffany's going to speak about bottom-up enforcement of, and protection of women's rights, so I'll leave that to her. So why I got interested in the subject, and I just did something really terrible. I don't know how to undo. But why I got interested in the subject is really that I was practicing law in South Africa in a really remote rural part of South Africa. And South Africa has a dual legal system. It has a tribal law legal system and what I'm going to refer to as a regular legal system, a common law legal system that we're all familiar with. And the process of appeal from the tribal law legal system goes to the common law legal system. And so, you got judges making decisions that would impact tribal communities, and those judges really didn't know a lot about those communities and didn't really understand tribal law. But I was involved in a lot of those appeals, and I actually saw the impact of decisions on women. So women being shut out of land ownership, women being shut out of custody of their children after a divorce, women just being excluded from the decision-making process and not even being treated as full legal majors. And so I became really passionate about that subject, ended up writing a doctoral dissertation about that. But there were a lot of discriminatory cultural practices that were going on. So female genital mutilation, not so much in South Africa. Violence against women was endemic, but there was no judicial intervention there. It was seen as a family problem. Women weren't being educated the same way that men were. And women just had no representation in public life. They weren't allowed to appear in front of courts. They had legal guardians who would appear on their behalf. And women were more likely to be poor. So they shut out of the economy and working informally, and so no protection should their spouse or provider die. And polygamy was fairly common as well. So if the provider died, it wasn't just affecting one wife and maybe those children. It could be affecting multiple wives and then multiple children as well. If I press this, will this change the slides? Yes. No, wrong way. Okay, there we go. So I'm going to talk about a United Nations convention called CEDAW. It's the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. And so this is the sort of top-down approach, the United Nations saying, okay, women have to have these rights. You need to end discriminatory practices, cultural practices, end stereotyped roles for men and women, enact legislation that guarantees non-discrimination and equality for women. And a lot of African countries signed on to that treaty. They signed on with a lot of reservations, saying, oh, well, if it comes to family law matters, then we don't agree with that. If it comes to personal law or Sharia law, we reserve the right to give that law form preference over women's rights. So African countries decided they were going to enact their own version of CEDAW, which they did in 2003. It's called the Maputo Protocol. And it emphasizes the idea of dignity. Women should be equal in dignity to men, because that's really not true in some of the customary law systems. And then the Millennium Development Goals, the United Nations in 2000 came up with some Millennium Development Goals, two of which was work towards gender equality and guarantee maternal health care, access for pregnant women to health care for themselves and for their children as well. So the sort of top-down approach. So let me just, oh gosh, I'm going the wrong way, sorry. Okay. Let me back up 1 second. So the Maputo Protocol is, I think, the first international document, certainly the first African document, that actually guarantees the right to abortion for women who have been the victims of incest, rape, or in cases where their life is endangered as well. And that was a really big cultural shock for, I think, a lot of African countries. And many African countries were really reluctant to sign on to this protocol because of that particular provision. So looking at what countries have done in terms of their constitution, so South Africa enacted a really progressive constitution post-apartheid. So it guaranteed protection from violence, whether it was public violence, so violence enacted by the government, or private violence, violence at the hands of a loved one. Had affirmative action for women, had preferenced the common law legal system over tribal law. So if tribal law was discriminatory towards women, then the Constitution said that the common law system prevailed and that tribal law or tribal court could not enforce discriminatory provisions. But where, de facto, whether that worked, I think, is a completely different matter. So South Africa has one of the highest rates of violence against women in the world, unfortunately. Perhaps matched by the DRC. In rural areas where people are pretty ignorant about the common law legal system, polygamy is very common. In fact, South Africa's president has 4 wives, so sets the example that polygamy is still very acceptable. There's the highest rise in HIV/AIDS rates is among young women, and those women who are being infected are women who are in a committed relationship like marriage, but often polygamous marriages, because obviously they're being exposed not only to their husband's sexual history, but the sexual history of the other wives that their husband may have. And in terms of political life, yes, we have some women ministers, but we're not seeing true gender equality in public and political life. And so South Africa was, I think, a good example. Zimbabwe, where I was born and grew up, fared even worse. So the earlier constitution in Zimbabwe actually preferenced customary law traditions. And so they said, if there's a conflict between women's rights and customary law, then customary law, tribal law, gets preference. Okay. So if there's a discriminatory cultural practice, that's okay. And they didn't reference violence at all. There was no affirmative action. And no reference to issues that many women care about, which is access to clean water, access to health care, and access to economic support or resources, food security, those kind of things. So Zimbabwe enacted a new constitution in 2013, and basically they said if there's a customary or discriminatory practice that conflicts with the equality rights in the constitution, then that cultural practice is void. And then they also guaranteed freedom from violence, whether it's public violence on the part of the state or private violence at the hands of a loved one. Guaranteed the right to health care, guaranteed the right to affirmative action, and the right to food and water and a clean environment. Equal access to land as well, which is something that women had been previously shut out from. No, I'm going the wrong way again, sorry. But whether the courts have actually been that great about enforcing those legal provisions, not so much. So the South Africa Constitutional Court has a very good tradition of enforcing women's rights and equality rights and freedom from discrimination. Zimbabwe upheld a customary law right that prohibited women from inheriting property in a famous case. Botswana actually has been pretty progressive. So in the Unity Dow case, under traditional African customary law, women are prohibited from passing along their citizenship to their children. Citizenship follows the male. And Unity Dow was a young woman who was married to an American, and she lived in Botswana, and she wanted her children to be citizens of Botswana. And the tribal court said, no, you know, they follow the husband, so your children are American, even though they were born in Botswana. So she filed a lawsuit, and the court actually said, you know, women have the right to pass along their citizenship to their children. And so she won that suit. And Kenya also recently has recognized the right of a woman to inherit property, even though under customary law she's normally prohibited from doing so. So it's kind of a checkered history, but some positive trends. But a really positive trend that I'm happy to report. So the Rwandan parliament is predominantly female, and I think it's the only parliament in the world that has more women than men, and significantly so. 64% of the Rwandan legislature are women, which I think is pretty amazing. And it started off with a quota. And I know when I say affirmative action, Americans kind of, you know, are not normally quick to endorse that. But starting off with a quota saying 25% of the legislature needs to be women. And that's what Rwanda had done after the genocide. And now that quota is unnecessary because 64% of the Rwandan parliament is comprised of women. So a lot of African countries, South Sudan in their transitional constitution of 2013, has also implemented a quota system. 25% of the legislature has to be women. Just because women often, not always, because as we heard this morning, you know, there are diversity of opinions among women, but women are more prone to legislate about issues that are supportive of other women. So access to water, access to a clean environment, healthcare, maternal healthcare. So that's one positive thing. Then there is a picture of Unity Dow, the person who brought the case about Botswana's citizenship. So she became the first female judge of the Botswana High Court, and actually was very critical. Her vote was very critical in a case the court heard about the rights of the sand people in the Kalahari Desert. And last year, she became the Minister of Education in Botswana. So all because she had the courage to kind of stand up and say, no, I'm going to, you know, stand up for my rights and take that lawsuit to court. So there she is, current Minister of Education in Botswana. But there's still obviously major issues to be resolved. So there's still stereotyped roles for men and women in terms of who's getting the water. And if you're walking miles to get the water, you don't have time to be in school. Okay, if you're in a polygamous relationship through no choice of your own because you were in a child marriage or because your legal male guardian decided that you should marry this person who already had four wives, you're much more likely to end up with HIV or AIDS through no fault of your own. So, and just the idea of women in conflict situations. Unfortunately, Africa's experienced more than its fair share of conflict. And when women are displaced from their homes, they're much more likely to be the victims of rape or violence. So about 200,000 women in the DRC have been raped. There are women being raped in Sudan, for example, mass rapes of women there. Rwanda, during the genocide, about 500,000 women were victims of rape. So the numbers are staggering. So there's a lot of work to do, but not to be Pollyanna-ish about this, but we're lawyers, and if we believe in law, to me, starting with the law is crucial. Because it's all very well to change and work to change things from bottom up, and I do really believe and support that and endorse that idea. But you have to have a law in place that protects women and that guarantees their rights. And you have to have fora where they can enforce those rights as well, enable them to go to court, enable them to sue, give them the power to change their own lives. So things to work on is, to me, not thinking about things like access to water, access to a clean environment as second generation rights, but more as rights that women need now, okay? That we really need to concern ourselves about those. And yes, obviously civil and political rights, religious freedom, all of those rights are crucial. But these social economic rights that we've kind of considered as second generation rights, we'll get to those once we've ensured everyone has first generation rights, to me are critically important for women. And so I'm going to at some point turn it over to Tiffany to talk about maybe not achieving those, but how we can achieve those from the bottom up. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Ernie and the journal, for hosting this very important symposium. Writing this presentation was probably the toughest thing I've had to do in 12 years, honestly. Because what does a North London Jewish boy, middle class, have to say about women's rights in the world? And I really struggled there. And those of you prospective lawyers are happy to know I pulled in an all-nighter. I'm still not happy with my draft. And I think this is maybe the sixth or my seventh draft. So I went back to the questions that essentially we were asked. I mean, we were asked, how are women's rights advantaged? Do Muslim women need rescuing? Is the women's rights movement another form of imperialism? These are all incredibly important questions, and as lawyers, you are going to face them, whether you are practicing here in the United States or whether it is you're practicing anywhere else in the world. You're going to be facing this challenge because ultimately the law is about personal relationships, your relationship with your client, and your ability to represent your client to the best of your abilities. So the way I approach these questions is by looking at methods. I'm a methods person. I teach methods at Syracuse. I like legal methods, and I like legal theory. So that's really where I'm going to ground my presentation. I go to my safe zone. I know it's not the most exciting thing to hear, but methods make everything, to me, makes more sensible. It's very difficult to compare apple and oranges if you don't do the methods aspect. So let's first of all begin by thinking, what did feminism emerge for? I mean, what was its purpose? And one of the arguments is that it was supposed to provide supposed to provide a women's perspective on issues such as the law, the structure, society. I mean, we've all read and know these cases like Bradwell and others, where we hear these very unusual approaches to the law. I still remember in 1988 going to the courtroom in the UK and seeing a judge essentially chastising a woman advocate for wearing a trousers suit and being absolutely staggered. I still recall that, you know, until the late 1980s, a woman could not reject her husband if she was in a marriage under English law. This is Western societies. So, and kind of, I'm going to premise that, I'm going to lead that into the question about imperialism. So when the early feminist movement started, and again, I'm from Syracuse, so also thank you very much for bringing me to a warmer climate. I really appreciate that. Secondly, so when the feminist movement started, especially in the Syracuse area in Seneca Falls, it was about getting the right to vote, the suffragettes movement. This was really what the movement initially was about, and it was premised on the idea, once we have the vote, we can engage in civil and political change. Once we can change the legislation, we can address all of those inherent inequalities that were so fundamental into the in the patriarchal system that we heard so that was described so eloquently earlier on. But it wasn't enough. Right? Changing the law doesn't change practices sometimes, especially practices in the private sphere. You know, we do have a tremendous amount of women in parliament. We have a tremendous amount of representation. I have most of my colleagues are women professors, and yet there are still some fundamental structural problems in our own modern society. So, for example, and I have a young daughter. I know that if she was to go into the workforce today, she would be earning 70 cents to the dollar compared to a man. We have laws to address those issues, and this is here in the West. At the same time, when we're looking into the developing world, it is abundantly clear that there has been progress. Yes, Rwanda definitely leads the way in terms of women's representation, and I actually also sort of looked into the inter-parliament unions list. So Rwanda is number one, Bolivia is second, Cuba is third, Seychelles is fourth, Sweden is fifth. That's the first Western country, by the way. Senegal follows Sweden, then Mexico. My own country, the UK, ranked 48th in terms of women's representation. The United States, 95th in terms of representation. So again, when you're trying to address this issue of imperialism, how terrifying it is that here again in the United States we don't even come close to having equality. When it comes to the political sphere. The other thing that struck me is that as I was doing the research for this presentation, in 2015, there was a report that came out and that said that it would take 118 years for women to achieve parity in terms of pay. 118 years. Staggering, right? This report came out in 2015. There was a similar report in 2011. That said that it would only take 98 years. What happened? Eh? And again, the report from the World Forum Development didn't really explain that. So how are we going to address the civil and political element where, again, social and economic rights are so undermined? So in the 1960s and 1970s, a new set of feminist movement emerged, really sort of focusing on this, on structural changes, recognizing that really what we have is a structural problem. Changing the law doesn't impact so much if in the private sphere we're not really addressing the inequalities. So we began to engage in other mechanisms. We promote education, we promote empowerment, and there has been substantial increase in women attending schooling all over the world. I mean, the numbers are actually quite staggering, although nobody seems to often ask what is being taught in those facilities. And this is something that, again, as advocates, I would encourage you to think about. It's one thing to have all of these wonderful figures and statistics. If you don't go and actually figure out what's being done, what's being educated, and how the education is being provided, you are not really engaging in an empowerment process. In the 1990s, again, we had a new movement of feminist movement, the more intersectional element, where, again, the focus was very much, it wasn't just about being a biological woman or a Western woman, it was also about being an African woman and about a Muslim woman. And what was so fascinating when you read the literature on this is it makes you understand, again, that we are not that women are not all the same. And it's, you know, often when you travel down to D.C. or you meet with policymakers, they seem to have this notion that we can have a template. You know, let's just do X, Y, and Z, and that's going to get us into the right place. This is why, again, first of all, the top-down approach is definitely important, but the bottom-up approach is unbelievably important, because society, the only way that we're going to address inequality in society is by engaging with local communities, getting the activities, getting the actions to bring about change. So if I was to go back to my initial three questions, I would make the following argument. First of all, we have to end this notion of a public-private divide. I appreciate, especially here in the United States, that people are very, very hesitant about letting the state, whichever way you want to describe it, come into the private realm, especially, you know, we are talking about 50 years after Griswold. But it's really important to actually engage in a conversation about this notion of a public-private divide, because it can be so detrimental to issues of empowerment. Secondly, I would make the argument that really we need to maybe stop talking less about equality and more about rights. Equality is often a subjective form. My wife and I are not equal, physically, biologically. She's certainly smarter than I am, and she has far too much patience than I have. You know, we both follow Syracuse basketball, and whereas I'm often screaming at the TV, she's saying to me, patience, patience. They will turn things around. They haven't yet, and they're unlikely to do so, but that's the reality. I may be a little bit more emotional. All of those things may come into the equation. So I would definitely argue for more of a rights approach to empowerment as opposed to justice and equality. Because again, often when you start engaging in the equality, what I often find is that you get into cultural discussions. And then finally, I think we need to recognize that some people need to emphasize that sometimes rescuing, it's not a bad word, okay? It's not imperialism to say that we have to rescue girls who are being sold into prostitution. It's not imperialist to say no more forced marriages. Because again, we're addressing HIV, we're addressing all these cultural norms. The essence of society is progress. Because if it wasn't, we would still be in a position where at least in the Western world, women were still being sold as chattel, as they do in so many locations. And again, we have to remember that women and girls endure enormous amount of sexual abuses. And just to give you an example, one of the projects that I'm involved with at Syracuse is dealing with transnational criminal organizations. And we study these entities. Human trafficking is a $32 billion industry. $32 billion industry affecting 2.5 million women and girls directly. And we're not even talking about all of the other consequences, the health issues, the rescuing aspect. 800,000 young girls are annually traded as a commodity in the world. What are we doing about this? You know, we can say our governments are doing X, Y, and Z until we actually go into a lot of the locations and provide support for these young girls, we are not going to get that much progress. So I'm somewhat comfortable saying, you know, we need to rescue certain people because certain people are in need of our help. You know, when we are living in a community, it is our obligation to support those who are less fortunate, or those who have been victimized, to put it in a different way, those who have been victimized by cultural and legal, sometimes, again, very often, some of these practices have been adopted through a legal system. And I'm very, very comfortable going to people and saying, you know what, slavery, it's wrong. Doesn't matter which culture you're from, it's fundamentally wrong. And if you think I'm imposing my Western values, fine, let's have a debate, let's have a discussion. But at the end of the day, it's wrong. And this is kind of where I get very, very animated, because you know, when you're dealing with some of these issues, you're dealing with real with people. And I also teach refugee and asylum law. And again, one of our key challenges is to provide, trying to assist women who have been either been trafficked or are in forced marriages because they simply don't meet the threshold of the law. And yet, these are real, real victims. Now, for that, I would argue, for this, we really need a new system of law. We need to engage with our policymakers about how to change our mechanisms. And for that, I am very hopeful that some of you will actually pick up the baton or the flag and engage in some of these conversations and bring about the change that we so desperately need. Thank you very much.
Well, I've been so impressed already. I'm not a professor, and I don't have one of these beautiful accents, so bear with me. I wish that I did. But for those of you who know a little bit about my background, for the last 6 years, I've stepped into a calling that has, as I used to say and still do say, is going to the king. So much of what I have done has really been this top-down approach of recognizing the importance of supporting people from the top down, from changing the laws, from changing the systems, and advocating so that there is freedom from the bottom up. But so much of my presentation today is really going to be about localized top down, so the small community top down, but more importantly, kind of that grassroots bottom up. But I think it will complement, hopefully, a lot of what has already been said. When we were asked to speak on this panel, we talked a lot about this concept of universalism versus cultural relativism and which is the appropriate response. And I think so often we in the West just assume that that question has already been answered for us and we don't really grapple with it. I think probably it's safe to say for most of you in the room, you believe that these rights were God-given. And so it is universal, and it isn't imperialistic to go ahead and advocate for those, but that hasn't necessarily been received and accepted by other parts of the world. From the very beginning, I will tell you that I believe in universalism. I believe that these are God-given rights. But I believe also that we are dealing with cultural sensitivities and have been even since the signing of the Universal Declaration. And we had countries like Saudi Arabia who wouldn't sign it because it imposed a Western ideology. So go all the way back. This isn't a new discussion. But I do encourage you to recognize the discussion and make sure that you are well-versed to understand your points of argument so that change can be brought out, whether that is at the localized level or from the top-down level, as many of you may engage with in the years to come, or the bottom-up. I'm going to bypass a lot of the law and the things that I would have said there, and start really with a paraphrase of Michael Inaktie, which, if you don't know him, he's a conservative thinker out of Canada, currently a professor at Harvard. But he says, for human rights to be globally accepted, it must go deeply local first. It must address plural philosophies and beliefs that sometimes collide with or appear to resist its appeal to a universal norm. Universal human rights standards must demonstrate relevance in the context and customs. In this vein, for effective advocacy to move through these communities where cultural, tribal, or religious norms conflict with these ideas of universal norms, we must first go deep into those cultural traditions and into the religious traditions. And I will go through some examples here because I want to show you some of what's actually going on in the world of advocacy from the localized level all the way through. And so we're going to see if I can start here. So this is on a very micro level, the top down. And I don't mean that necessarily from a legislative level, but it is at a community level. So this last August, I took a vacation to Iraq, which, you know, seems completely normal considering the circumstances. But I really wanted to understand what was going on the ground and what was happening to the internally displaced Iraqis as well as the Syrians who had moved into Iraq as refugees. And one of the things that I came across, and it was incredible, was this Yazidi community who had been moved off of Sinjar Mountain and who were living outside in a refugee camp outside of Duhok, Iraq, in the Kurdistan region. And to learn about their faith and to learn a little bit about what was happening in the community. So Iraq is a very traditional, honor-driven society, and that is even probably more so in the Yazidi community. In the Yazidi religion, if you don't know much about it, it's an ancient religion that kind of crosses with Zoroastrianism and then Sufism. And specifically, Yazidis have very strict regulations on conversion. So there was no practice that you could convert to another faith in return. They have very strict practices on honor and the female dignity when it comes to her purity and how that would bring honor to a family. So if a woman was raped, there were honor killings at times because that would bring shame to the entire community. Move into the present circumstances and you have the Islamic State, or as they refer to him, and I often do, Daesh, and the circumstances have dramatically changed. So I was introduced to this community and got to learn about what they were doing from the top down internally within their community to address some of these issues. So I'm going to say, how did it start? There was a Yazidi activist, a male activist, who is also a director at the University of Duhok, who decided to work among his community to bring about change actually in religious doctrine even, so that the women who were returning from their captivity with Daesh were going to be able to be accepted back into their community. Many of them had faced rape. Many of them were returning pregnant. Many of them had been forcibly converted to Islam. And so, at the beginning level, this activist met with the religious leaders, Baba Sheikh specifically here in the picture, who is the head religious leader really over the Yazidi community, and they started to address the issue. Well, Baba Sheikh can pardon individuals from a religious standpoint, but if you're going to start changing doctrine, he has to go to the Council of Religious Leaders. And so they sat down as a community and decided that with the magnitude of the situation for their religious community, change had to come about. The leaders then went about and actually issued a doctrinal statement changing part of the cultural practices in the Yazidi faith and the faith community inside of Iraq. And they specifically said, for the Yazidis who have converted, come back. We will put you through a religious ceremony, a ceremony that hadn't existed previously, where they would enter a specific holy temple and be rebaptized into the faith, completely new. But they also then are now dealing with, of course, the honor and the dignity and having to tell communities and very broadly, again, from that leadership level of the religious community, that we will accept these women back into our fold as full and complete despite the sexual violence that they have faced, something that, of course, cannot bring shame because it was not done at their choice. So really some radical things happening and successful in large part because, yes, it started with somebody within the community, but there was buy-in at the leadership level. So incredible things already happening. There's still a lot to go in the region, so I don't want to say that we're done with yet. But there was a woman, a survivor, who said, for us, our tradition is the most important thing. She went on to explain how thankful she was for these new religious interpretations and the doctrine so that she could be reunited with her family. She spoke about how her mother, father, and husband were still missing and that her home in Sinjar had been destroyed. She was presently living with her uncle's family in a camp for the internally displaced near Duhok. She said, I don't know how else to say it. I was just so happy because I had been hurt she referring to her sexual assaults that she had experienced in captivity, and I want to be clean again. So again, we're not finished. There's a lot, especially because they're struggling now what to do with the children who were born as a result of the rape. And the Kurdish parliament is having a very difficult time dealing with this, in large part because people are not accepting of those children. So there's still much to go, but definitely an example of success. And I'm going to have to speed through this here. Speaking of another one, we'll go to Senegal real quick. This is, again, another important example of local leadership stepping up. So in Senegal, it started with really one organization called Tostan. It started with one village. It started with going in and educating this village who had a customary practice of female genitalia mutilation, so FGM cutting. There's multiple names for this. We're just going to call it FGM if that's okay with all of you. But Tostan took it out upon themselves to go in and educate this community. They started first with the women, and they said, what are some of the maternal health issues you're facing? Well, let's talk about some of the consequences of FGM. And they started to see correlations between the maternal health issues and this traditional practice. The women then went to their husbands and their fathers and took the education, and the husbands and fathers went to the chiefs of the tribe. And all of a sudden, in this one village, things started to stir. And as we've heard earlier, many of them thought that the cultural practice was based on Islamic law. It wasn't. They went to the imam, and the imam said, this is not based on Islamic law. And he set about publicly proclaiming the end to FGM in his village. But he took it even a step further. He said, this isn't going to change for the women in Senegal unless there's more buy-in in the other tribes. So here this imam set out and walked from village to village, teaching the other chiefs and the other imams in the villages the same. And we've already seen multiple villages. It's been plus upwards about a dozen already that have eradicated this entire practice, customary practice, really on the basis of education. So again, so important that the leadership bought in. But just a side note here, Tostan, the organization, was run by an American. She moved into the community, and she decided that she was going to engross herself in the knowledge of the customary practices so that she could engage. So I think this is a very prime example that while it's incredibly important to have the community and the cultural buy-in, there is a role for us, even as Westerners, to play in that. So really some more specific grassroots. This one I love. Samburu Girls Foundation is based in Kenya, and it's an organization that I was able to work with and draft some amicus briefs for some Kenyan courts, really based on international law and law that Kenya had signed in particular. So again, FGM is a practice form in many of the tribal communities inside of Kenya. Samburu Girls Foundation was started from a young girl from the Samburu tribe. She had faced these cultural customs. She was educated to become the nurse of the community, and in the process is setting about to change the customs of her own community. In Kenya, it is illegal. FGM is illegal, but rarely prosecuted. So this has a multi-approach to it, essentially trying to change and educate through the community, actually rescuing girls who have been forced into child brides, forced with FGM, and then also a customary practice called beating. So in the Samburu tribe in particular, the Moranas, the young warriors from the age of 15 to 35, are not permitted to marry. And so instead, they allow what's called beating, so to put on the red customary beads, which essentially is an engagement practice for a young girl, generally somebody of your actual bloodline family, for sexual purposes. And so some from the age of 6 onwards. And so in the Samburu Girls Foundation, Josephine Kulule, as I said, she was a part of this community and set about to change it. She has rescued over 235 girls already, many of whom now are removed from the community and going through education, but she hasn't left the community, and nor have these girls. Just recently, and I love this, there was a partnership between San Bernardino Girls Foundation, Too Young to Wed, which is a an organization out of the United States, and Fujifilm to offer this photography workshop. And this is a picture actually that comes from that workshop. And what essentially they did, they had the women who were saved pair up, and they had to share their stories. And for many of these girls, they had never shared their stories before, and they kind of thought that they were alone in them, despite the customary practices. And there was healing that came through this process. But the end result was what's so amazing, is that there was this end exhibition, and they invited the tribal leaders to come. And they even invited some of the parents who had sold their girls or forced them into these practices. And so just a few weeks ago, 70 of them came, many of whom were tribal chiefs and the villages, and each girl presented the photos. And a few of them shared their story. All of them shared their dream of what they wanted to be, something bigger than what they'd ever been able to dream before. And all of them begged the chiefs to discontinue these practices in their village because they had been painful and hurtful to them. The reports have come back that the women, the girls in particular, were crying, but so were the chiefs, and so were their parents. And so it's too early to tell what the effects may be of that, but we have to see that there is certainly change happening within the community. Many of you know the story of Malala education, and I'm gonna speed through this one since her story is so familiar, but I would just say that the reports and statistics that show that educating the mother is educating a nation is phenomenal. You're not just educating one. And there was a UN cluster survey back in 2010 and 2011 out of the Afghanistan that collected data from all of the provinces, 34, even the ones that are Taliban controlled. And they were monitoring about 80 different indicators, so human development indicators, so access to clean water, school and education, the dropout rate, the mortality rate, poverty levels. And the single greatest predictor for each indicator was whether the mother was educated. This one isn't done yet. So My Stealthy Freedom is out of Iran. I have had the pleasure of meeting the woman who started this, Masih Alinejad, and she is a female journalist who had to leave Iran due to political pressure. She started a blog and encouraged women to exercise the right to remove the hijab, a mandatory covering that is implemented pretty strictly inside of Iran. Now, she didn't say that it was wrong to wear the hijab. She was just trying to enforce that women had the right to choose. So, go back, sorry. So women all over Iran, and frankly, all over the world, in solidarity with them, started taking pictures and video of them removing the hijab. And some of them took pictures with their sister, where one of them removed the hijab and one of them was dressed strictly in the chador and said, "We have the right to choose." And this has started somewhat of a political movement that's been responded by the Iranian parliamentarians, not necessarily in a positive way yet. You'll see in 2015, the Iran morality police stopped 3.6 million women in the street for improper clothing. And that could mean, one of the women told me a story that she was on her cell phone, and to be so, her sleeve was showing, and she was stopped because her wrist was showing. So I actually love this, though. So just recently, last month, the Iranian youth are very creative, and they created a phone app to tell others where these morality police were, right? So if you've ever used the Waze app, it kind of dinks you, warning, warning, so that you could reroute yourself. Iran is already trying to block the app, but it's showing you that the youth in Iran, which, by the way, 70% of the country is under the age of 35, are very moderate and looking for change in their most of them would say they are Muslims, but they are looking for change and freedom and reform with the understanding of the Shia law that is imposed there. But I love that it even went further than that, because inside of Iran, as a woman, you cannot travel or leave the country or even have access to a passport unless your father or your husband has granted you that access. You can't have full access to your children if there's a divorce. And so what started happening, honestly, as an offshoot, not even asked for, is that the men started taking pictures of themselves, and it was called It's Men's Turn, and they are transferring their rights back to their wives and to their daughters publicly. The final one, and I'm going to make it as short as I possibly can. Morocco, incredible example that took years. But when it became essentially free and an independent state in 1956 from France, enacted a personal status code that was based off of their understanding, one interpretation of Islamic jurisprudence, and it essentially created women to be dependents of their fathers, of their husbands, needing permission, many things that we've already heard today. And in 1980, there was this rise of fundamental Islamic understanding and kind of a pushback to make it even more Islamic, their interpretation of Islam. And so the women who had started this movement already inside of Morocco, many of whom were secularist, decided that they were going to go study the Quran and create their own arguments from the Quran and from the Hadith and the Sunnah to say, this isn't what Islam is. And we're going to go through this here quickly. There were several stages. You'll see from the enactment, the rise of Islam, there was a million signature campaign that was launched that was successful in 1992, that then in 1993, there were some changes brought about that the king announced that didn't go quite far enough that the women were seeking, and so they put together again another multi-pronged approach, actually looking to various Muslim women in other even nations to start addressing what Islam really says about women and freedom. And a new package of reforms were announced in 1999, which a new king, King Hussein had already died, and Muhammad the Sixth had arrived, and we ended up seeing essentially a complete change almost of the family law by 2003. Now, the king did say, "I cannot," this is a quote, "I cannot in my capacity as a commander of the faithful permit what God has forbidden, nor forbid what the Almighty has allowed." And he said this to the parliament because the law still did not completely abolish polygamy or the unilateral repudiation of the wife by the husband and certain separation compensations and discrimination and inheritance rules. But it had progressed a long way. And then lastly, we saw in 2011 that the new constitution actually guarantees again the right to women and men. So still a long way to go, but although this is another example that it was grassroots initiated, but it did require that top down as well change of the law. So I will leave it there so that we can go to question and answers.
That was a great panel. Would you just join me in thanking this group for what they shared? I think the things you shared were challenging in many ways, but also I think really encouraging. I really appreciate the stories of hope and progress that is being made, and I think that's been important today. We've got 9 minutes before we need to break, and so I'm just going to turn to, all right, we've got 15 minutes. Before we need a break. So I'm going to turn to questions from the audience first. So who'd like to ask a question? Yes. And we have microphones, Mr. Casey.
Okay, this question was for Isaac because you brought up the idea of human trafficking. And as I see this conference being in, you know, Griswold as a lever or fulcrum of sorts for women's rights, does it not I mean, and given that probably the vast majority of the customers in human sex trafficking are men, does it not suggest that Griswold, in making sexuality very disposable, ultimately has contributed to the spread of sex trafficking? Because in order to eliminate the natural consequence of procreation, that it allows women to be exploited as a commodity rather than respected as a woman who has the capacity for motherhood?
That's a tough question and a tricky one for me to sort of to wrap my head around, especially because I'm not an Americanist, nor am I a constitutionalist. I can tell you that generally in the world outside of the United States, women are very often seen as a commodity. You'll often see in the developing world, you know, the younger daughters, especially if it's a big family, being traded off for the better of the family or for the security of the family. So I would go back sort of to Christine's points and emphasize it's social and cultural and economic values that have not been addressed, that have undermined the value of women. You know, people have used culture as an excuse to not educate women. They've used it as an excuse not to allow women into the... let me rephrase it. They have used it as an excuse to prevent women from entering the workforce. So I'm often very apprehensive about the type of arguments that you were suggesting, because I do think there are certain, there'd be very unhelpful developments in this realm where individuals latch on to sexuality instead of looking really at the bigger picture and what's been happening.
Right, other questions? Yes.
Thank you all for coming. My question is, I agree with and understand the bottom up and the top down. What can we do to actually enforce the top down? Seems to be that it's getting implemented on both ends, but it's not actually coming into the center.
So I think many women, particularly women in rural areas and in the developing world, are completely ignorant of their rights. So for example, South Africa enacted a law, and they can't change polygamy overnight, especially since the president is polygamous. So what they did was they said, okay, what is one of the sort of evils that accompanies polygamy? It's that women are left in poverty if the man dies. That's one of them. And so how can we address that if we cannot stop polygamy? So what they did was they passed a law, and they said, if you're going to enter a polygamous marriage, you need to go down to the courthouse and you need to tell someone there, like register. There's this procedure where you register your marriage and you tell people what is going to happen when you die and how your wives and children are going to be provided for. Okay, which sounds great, but nobody does it. So I think that sort of educating women about their lives, like having people like the example that Tiffany provided of that American woman who started a foundation and was like living in the community and immersing herself in knowledge about the community's customs, and then saying, okay, so how can I change this? I think people going to the community and trying to figure out what is the root of these problems, or what are some of the implications of these issues, and then educating women about that and sort of saying to them, okay, what is going to happen to you? You're wife number 8. What is going to happen to you when your husband dies? And he's fathered 56 children. What are you going to do then? Are you going to have a place to live? Are you, what's going to happen? And so, and sort of educating women and representing women who want to challenge their situation and challenge the lives that have been forced upon some of them, I think.
I'll also just say that there are a few mechanisms, right, specifically for countries who've signed some of these international covenants to, at least through peer pressure somewhat, enforce them. They're only so strong, but they are important, and there are nations and women who are bringing some of these rights up through some of those United Nations mechanisms. I also mentioned with the Samburu Girls Foundation that I participated as an amicus in an actual court in Kenya. And so there are ways and means to enforce this. At that time, for example, the Kenyans had the right laws on the books, but they didn't really want to enforce them, and there were these child bride issues happening, some by very educated men not in the rural area as well. And so there are great organizations on the ground in these countries who are trying to then enforce the law through the courts and seeing some success, but it has to start somewhere.
If I may add to this, in my recent trips to London and discussions with some women from South Africa, there is a movement now in England and in South Africa that we're helping with, which is called the registration of marriage. Because, for example, Muslim marriages are not being registered. Not just Muslim, Sikh are having the same problem, and a few other religions. And I think if we help that to change, that will help a great deal. Also, I think you have mentioned, I believe you mentioned that polygamy is not Islamic, it is cultural. And that is, again, something that could be educated about. If I may just mention one thing about your presentation, which is the part on Morocco. The reason is I'm very familiar with the situation there, and I wouldn't say that in the 80s there was a rise of Islam. Morocco is very steeped in the Islamic tradition. I would say there was a rise in political movements, probably that's what you meant, who were using Islam to advance their claims, and we've seen a lot of that. Now, there was a strong secularist women's movement in Morocco, and it does claim that it had advanced, it is responsible for all the changes that are happening in Morocco. I would first say that it's not that easy for someone to say, a secularist, I want to change, so I'll go study the Quran and I can do it. I know they claimed that, and I've seen their writings, but it's very shallow, and it does not really change seriously what needs to be changed. But what happened was that, yes, there was a raised consciousness in all of Morocco among women and men that this should be changed. And the king told them, go back. And he formed a council in which there were jurists, lawyers, women, Muslim scholars, and said, get this worked out. They worked it out and it passed. So I think we need to give credit to everybody, but your model is still correct that it is, in this case, well, maybe it is from the bottom up, from the top down, and the center also had a role in it. So maybe that's your answer.
I have notes on that commission. I was trying to rush through it, but I agree. Yeah. It really took a multi-pronged approach to have success there.
It was a very bright approach because once the law was passed, nobody was against it.
Right. Yeah. And just to pick up, if people are looking for things to do, so that convention that I mentioned, CEDAW, when a country signs on to that, they have to file reports with the committee every 4 years, with the UN CEDAW committee, about the status of women in their country and how things have changed. And many countries don't do that, or they file reports that say, you know, fabulous, yeah, don't worry about it. And so what the CEDAW committee has been allowing are shadow reports. So organizational individuals, you know, non-governmental organizations, human rights groups, to say, okay, that's the official version of events. Let me tell you what's really going on in the ground. And it doesn't have to be the whole status of women. It can focus on one particular issue. But the CEDAW committee has been really open to that. And they also have started taking individual complaints. So there's an individual complaint mechanism where an individual could go and say, my country signed onto this international treaty, but they're not protecting my rights, or they're not protecting me from child marriage, or they're not protecting me from, you know, FGM or whatever it is. And the CEDAW committee will intervene on their behalf and basically call the country to respond to those allegations and can order damages and various other things.
So you're very familiar with CEDAW. Did the U.S. Ratify that agreement? Okay. Do we know why?
I think because it has a section on reproductive health. It has a section on equality and education, and I guess a lot of homeschoolers turn around.
And yet the U.S. has been very instrumental in pressuring other countries to sign it who had similar objections to the ones the U.S. has. I remember talking to actually somebody in power, not rumors. And I had advised them that if they sign it, there are all these ramifications that we in the US are concerned about. And they said, in the end, we have to sign it because the US is pressuring us. And they, and by the way, the CEDA was not developed by a world community. It was developed by a group of people and then presented to everybody to be signed. And more of that, there is CEDAW 2 that has been in the works also, which is subject to a great deal of critique. We will not do it here. But when you hear about critique of the West, these are the kinds of things that we're talking about. You don't sign them, but you want others to sign them. Well, they have the same kind of respect for human life, whatever, as you do.
And just one point of clarification, the U.S. actually has signed it. We haven't ratified it.
Yeah.
And some
yeah.
of that, again, is just coming yeah. down to the political system in the United States. There is nothing prohibiting us at a diplomatic level signing a treaty, but whether it's going to be ratified in the Senate. And my understanding is it's never even been brought to a vote at the Senate floor.
No, it's, yeah. been, it's been through committee yeah. several times, but never. It was signed by Jimmy Carter in yeah. 1980, but never brought for a vote. It's been to committee and never put forward for a vote.
And there's only seven, as my understanding is, and I hope this is still correct, there's only seven countries who have not signed it.
I think they're few, and I think they're four.
Four now.
Yeah, yeah. But for me, the number of countries yeah. that sign it is not really convincing as to whether I should sign it or not. I should look at my own principles mm-hmm. about human life, about society, about dignity, whatever. I'm not saying all of these things are a problem in CEDAW. I'm just saying I cannot respond to the gallery. I have to respond to my own values. And so it's just sort of difficult for me to hear when I'm abroad that your country did not ratify, but we're being pressured to do so.
Let's take one more question, and then we're going to take our break for lunch. Yeah, Sandrine, two more? All right. Two more questions. Sandrine.
Okay. So I have a question on just what exactly organizations or governments are doing on prosecuting transnational criminal organizations?
Okay. unfortunately, not very much. That's the reality. So, it's one thing to talk about, the more vicious aspect of the, the trade in women and the trade in prostitution. But if I was to say to you that the number one money earner for a transnational criminal organization, it's actually counterfeit pharmaceutical drugs. That's the biggest earner, about $40 billion a year. It's not dealt with. There's a very strong also gender element here that you can bring in. Young girls being compelled to taking dieting pills and buying it on the internet. And a lot of those types of pharmaceutical things that individuals are being sort of encouraged to purchase. The FBI tried. I think it annually closes down about 10,000 websites of these sort of small mom and pops organizations where they engage in pharmaceutical drugs selling. But we often forget that it's really the small white collar crime that facilitates a lot of the hard crimes when it comes to the trafficking of women. So again, as a university lecturer, I can tell you that about $1 billion a year is being spent on buying faked essays. When you go online, it's the last minute, you think, I'm going to buy an essay quickly.
We don't know anything about that here.
No, obviously. I'm not suggesting, I'm just saying, around the massive world, you get to see those things. Now, this is, again, it's a cultural thing, right? Because we think this is a victimless crime. I mean, what's spending $200 on an essay just to get an A? But it's the money that's being used. Now, very often what will happen is that money could be used for either for the selling of drugs, for gender violence, empowering specific individuals. So we really need to take a much more comprehensive approach and recognize that everything that we do, every action has a consequence. And when we're looking at the activities and how we address inequality, lack of parity in pay, we have to sort of look at ourselves. And I accept the argument that, you know, we shouldn't be looking at the gallery. Definitely, we need to start with ourselves. One way we start with ourselves, let's address inequality in pay here in the United States. Let's start with that. And then, you know, address some of those issues. And that sort of will cascade into other elements.
Can I say just one more thing? I think we should combine this with the issues of rape, because a lot of the women who get raped feel dirty, like you mentioned, that they're not pure anymore. What do they do with their lives? If we don't help them, then they're gonna, you know, deteriorate in their lives into and become victims for these kinds of behaviors. I would like to add that the example you mentioned about the Yazidi women and what the sheikh there did really moved me, because I went through this when Bosnia was going through this. And a lot of the Bosnian women who were raped felt that, you know, did I commit adultery? Because adultery is, you know, you can't commit it. It's a sin. How could I get rid of this sin? What happened to me? Am I worth anything? And some of them were pregnant. And what about the child? And their sheikhs also told them, first of all, the children are innocent. Second of all, force was used, so you did not commit adultery. You are okay. You're pure. And all of this is, I think, one way in which we really need to rush to these women and help them so that they don't become prey for prostitution. And the one thing that has become clear throughout the last few decades is that when war happens, women's rights are horribly violated.
Now let's take one last question. Yes.
First of all, thank you so much for coming. This has been a really enjoyable opportunity. My question would be, in your perceptions, each of your perceptions, to what degree do you think that the global celebration of the same-sex marriage movement and the legalization of same-sex marriage, how will that affect women's rights or the rights of minor females? Do you perceive any effect there?
So we'll just finish with an easy question. So,
No, I if I can answer it from a certain perspective, you probably were not raising. I wrote about that from a feminist point of view, I think in the 70s, it's published in a book on mothering, and I mentioned how male gay marriages are going to end up affecting very much the rights and power of women in society. This is something really troubling from a women's point of view because they're sort of marginalized now in some, especially if we have cloning, if we have, you know, all sorts of other technological development that make the reproductive ability of the woman marginalized. If you're asking about, excuse me, if you could repeat your question, that's the one thing I wanted to talk about.
The globalization of the same-sex marriage movement affect women's rights. Will they be further considered as second class? Will maybe the rights of minor females be increase in abuse and things like that?
So I'm shooting from the hip here, but I would disagree with that. I would say that the number of people who participate in gay marriage is small because only a small section of the population is gay. And people who choose to participate in gay marriage, I think it's a really small section of the population. So I don't see it having a large impact on women's rights or women's roles either.
Go for it. Please.
Let you think a little longer. I would say that the one thing that I've come across, and it's a slightly tangential, except that one of the things we've been asked about here is imperialism and whether imposing, Western, versus universal human rights is in fact an imperialistic in its nature. And we've certainly seen a move in our foreign policy to make the LGBTQ rights a top priority in our foreign policy, to the point that we've had ambassadors leave their post, Kenya to be example, over the issue. And we have denied aid to certain countries who don't adjust their law accordingly. And I will say that if we believe in universal values and want to promote women's rights, they're going to be affected from a U.S. standpoint because our policy and ability to influence has already been affected by this issue. There were 13, I believe it was 13 heads of state from Africa who essentially said, take your aid and influence and go elsewhere. We're looking to China. And so from a place of influence, if we're looking at our foreign policy towards women's issue and wanting to promote that as well, that's already been endangered in many of these countries.
So, please, please, I can take more time.
No, I just wanted to say I agree. Your analysis is correct. Yeah.
Okay, can I disagree really quick?
Of course.
So I would say some of those countries who are looking to China, and I'm going to include Zimbabwe as one of those countries, have a terrible, terrible, terrible human rights record and would not take our influence anyway because they consider us Western imperialists. So, that's the only country that I can speak to with any knowledge about their looking to China. And I think it's not over that issue. I just think it's about they perceive us as Western imperialists anyway and would have gone elsewhere and go to China because China also has a terrible human rights record and doesn't care about their bad human rights record. So,
can I disagree? 30 seconds for any last comments on this or other questions. Yes, start with Dr. al-Hibri.
I will just say I think you've heard some wonderful remarks. And I will probably need a couple of weeks to answer it properly. So I will refer to it a little bit later. But my suggestion will be that sometimes here in the Western world, we tend to see issues as being more important than there are elsewhere. And I appreciate that the LGBT community here, it's a very important discussion. It is a very politically charged discussion. In other locations, you have other conversations that are much more pertinent, such as it's not whether I have the right to vote, it's whether I have the right to live, whether I have access to water. So I do think that we need to address some of these issues in an order of importance.
You can each have 30 seconds.
Okay. Yeah. I'm not even going to take 30 seconds, but I'm going to say in 1994, after apartheid, when South Africa enacted its first post-apartheid constitution, it was the first country in the world to guarantee no discrimination on the grounds of sexual orientation, and that was 1994, and end with that.
I would like to say that from my perspective on the rest of the world, there are a lot of people and governments who really love the United States as principles, as an ideal, even as a society, but they don't love our foreign policy. And they are being forced and pushed, kicking and screaming into another direction. This is how I see it.
No. Can I just say amen? No, I mean.
Okay, very good. Join me in thanking this panel.